Now every moment of my life,
every moment of my life,
yeah,
I'm gonna do my best.
Oh yes,
I don't know when I
would
die. I leave these earthly things.
So I will listen to your word, display my faithfulness, so true.
Because you gave your life for me, now I will give my life to you,
to you.
Welcome once again. This is the Know Your Bible broadcast on Church Media TT, the YouTube channel. Remember to subscribe and to push, or rather to select that notification bell. So once you press it, you'll be able to be informed of all the information that the Churches of Christ can share with you, the lessons being presented, and you will be further encouraged to know that God loves you greatly and He wants you to obey His wonderful gospel. Join with me in prayer at this time. Our Heavenly Father, as we come before you in prayer, we are thankful for this beautiful day. We are thankful for all the blessings which you continue to bestow upon us. We are thankful for your words which we could read and understand. May you help us to do so at this time so we can be drawn closer to you. These things we pray and ask in Jesus' name with thanksgiving. Amen and amen. Thank you for joining me in that prayer. In our last lesson, we looked at how the people of Samaria did not allow themselves to be governed by their ancestral history of antagonism or hostility towards their Jewish counterpart. But contrarywise, they wanted to hear the gospel of Christ because they anticipated the coming of Christ. However, there was another hurdle to cross over, another barrier to break down or remove. You see, in order to obey the gospel of Christ, there will be some obstacles in your path that needs to be removed, that needs to be laid aside or to get rid of totally. Maybe some bad habits or worldly influences. Some people might have smoking habits. Some people cannot get rid of the alcohol. Some people continue their sexual immorality in such a way that they refuse to stop. People who use obscene language or filthy language, people who continue to lie and to steal. Or maybe some people have certain religious traditions and customs that they are still holding on to. Superstitious beliefs, those who believe in voodoo or obia, as we are commonly known. Opinions or personal beliefs that are not in line with the scripture. But remember, Isaiah chapter 28, verse number 10 says, "For precept must be upon precept. Precept upon precept, line upon line, here a little, there a little." We must be able to understand the simplicity of the word of God, the simplicity of the gospel. So when you read Acts chapter number 8, as we continue from our last lesson, we'll be able to understand why it's important for us to focus on the gospel. Acts chapter 8 from verse 9 to verse number 11. The scripture reads, Acts chapter 8, 9 to 11. "There was a certain man called Simon, which before time in the same city used sorcery and bewitched the people of Samaria, giving out that himself was some great one, to whom they all gave heed from the least to the greatest, saying, 'This man is the great power of God.'" "And to him they had a regard because of that for a long time he had bewitched them with sorceries." Isn't it very interesting that you have a man that's mentioned in the scriptures? Because the scripture talks about a certain man. Anytime the word certain is used, emphatically, it means somebody or something or some person that has great weight or importance or significance. So here you have a certain man with a certain belief. His name is Simon. Simon also means hearing. So interesting in the fact that when we look at this man, Simon, we must not confuse Simon with the various Simons in the Bible. Because we have Simon Peter, mentioned in Matthew chapter 4 and verse number 18. We have Simon the Canaanite in Matthew chapter 10 and verse number 4. We have Simon the brother of our Lord, Matthew 13 verse number 55. We have Simon the father of Judas Iscariot, John 6 and verse number 71. We have Simon a Pharisee, Luke chapter 7 and verse number 40. Simon a leper, Matthew 26 and verse 6. Simon of Cyrene, the one who was compelled to bear our Lord's cross when he was no longer able to carry it, Matthew 27, verse number 32. Simon, a tanner at Joppa, with whom Peter lodged, Acts 9 and verse number 43. And then we come to Simon, a native of Samaria, a famous sorcerer. Let me tell you a few things about this Simon. He was well known in the city of Samaria. He was famous for his skill in sorcery and amazement. He is well respected by both the young and the old. He is recognized as having the manifestation of God's power. He has a long reputation that is supported by perhaps years of experience. He has credence, credibility, plausibility of the people of Samaria. In other words, they believed in him. But when you read Acts chapter 8 and verse number 12, it says, but when they believe Philip, very interesting conjunction, but when they believed Philip, preaching the things concerning the kingdom of God and the name of Jesus Christ, they were baptized, both men and women. What did the Samaritans believe? They believe in something and someone that they have heard. And it was also different to what they have known for a number of years. Because Simon the sorcerer had bewitched these people for a long time. But when Philip came preaching the gospel, they heard something. They heard about this person named Jesus. And now they were directing their attention to this particular message. Why is this message different? Because it's not mythical and fictitious. It's not based on religious traditions and customs. It's not based on sorcery and amazement. But what they have heard is real, is genuine, and life-saving. It's called the gospel of Christ. And there are two things that Philip mentioned that caused them to obey. The message concerning the kingdom of God. That's the first thing. The message concerning the kingdom of God. You see, when Jesus came in Mark chapter number 1, we read from verse number 14 and 15 that after John was put in prison, Jesus came into Galilee preaching the gospel of the kingdom of God, saying, the time is fulfilled, the kingdom of God is at hand, repent ye and believe the gospel. In Mark chapter number 8, verse 9 and verse number 1, whosoever therefore shall be ashamed of me and my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of him also shall the Son of Man be ashamed when he cometh in the glory of his Father with his holy angels. So Jesus saying, don't be ashamed of me, because there's something I'm coming to deliver to you that will change your life. And so in Mark chapter 9 and verse number 1, the scripture says, verily I say unto you that there be some of them that stand here which shall not taste of death till they have seen the kingdom of God come with power. I want us to understand that. That Jesus is saying, some of you very Jews, some of you very people will be alive when the kingdom of God comes. In John chapter number 3, when Jesus spoke with Nicodemus, Nicodemus, who is the Pharisee, the ruler of the Jews, he came to Jesus by night and he said, listen, Rabbi, we know that thou art a teacher come from God. Can no man can do these miracles that thou doest except God be with him. Jesus said in John chapter number 3 and verse number 3, verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Nicodemus said unto him, how can a man be born when he's old? Shall he enter the second time his mother's womb and be born again? Jesus said unto him, verily, verily, I say unto you, except a man be born of the water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God. Why is the kingdom of God so important? Because Jesus, when he came preaching, he was preparing the people to get ready for the kingdom of God to come. And so this is the reason why when Philip went down to the city of Samaria, he preached the message concerning the kingdom of God. The second thing he preached was the name of Jesus Christ. Could we recall in the book of Acts chapter number 2, when the apostles stood up on the day of Pentecost and they preached the wonderful gospel of Jesus Christ, his death, his burial, his resurrection? The last verse, rather, the verse that speaks of the end of the sermon, verse number 36, it says, therefore let all house of Israel know assuredly that God had made that same Jesus whom you have crucified both Lord and Christ. Now when they heard this, they were pricked in their heart and they said unto Peter and to the rest of the apostles, men and brethren, what shall we do? Then Peter said, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of your sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. So it means that in the name of Jesus Christ, salvation is granted unto all of you. In Acts chapter number 4, from verse number 10, when Peter and John were able to heal a man, and the people were questioning how this was done, they said in verse number 10, be it known unto you and to all the people of Israel that by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, whom God raised from the dead, even by him doth this man stand here before you whole. Then he continued to say, this is the stone which was set at naught of you builders, which has become the head of the corner. In other words, you Jews who rejected Jesus, you Jews who rejected the gospel message, he is the head of the corner. He is the head of the church. He is the king in his kingdom. And so in verse number 12, neither is there salvation in any other. There's none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. So could you imagine Philip going down to the city of Samaria? He's preaching the kingdom of God to them, and he's preaching the name of Jesus. So who and what did Samaritan believe in all of these years? In other words, what were they holding on to all of these years? They were holding on perhaps to their gods, as we saw in the history of the Samaritans. They were holding on to the teachings of Simon the sorcerer as he bewitched them. So they had all of these things that were hindering them from coming to Christ until Philip went down and preach the gospel. So you had a certain man, his name was Simon, with a certain belief, he practiced sorcery. Do you know anyone who is practicing strange beliefs or leading a congregation with teachings that are not in accordance with the word of God today? Do you know anyone? Do you know anyone who claims to manifest the power of God or is leading a congregation by saying God spoke to them directly or indirectly through other means of spiritual phenomenon, when it is certainly not thus said the Lord? You see, when Simon himself also believed, he had to leave his practicing profession as a sorcerer, possibly even his livelihood, if that is the way in which he lived. He had to leave his fame and popularity, his respect from the community for all these years. And then when he came to Christ that he can be saved. But the question is, when he did come to Christ, was he genuine or not? Well, we will find that out in our next lesson. So in Acts chapter number 8 and verse number 13, hear what the scripture says. Then Simon himself believed also, and when he was baptized, he continued with Philip and wondered, beholding the miracles and signs which were done. Pay attention to the word beholding. It means to gaze, to look with interest and for a purpose, usually indicating a careful observation of details. So while Philip was performing these miracles, here is Simon gazing, paying close attention, because his mind now is going to go back into something that he once did before. We have to understand that there are certain lifestyles that we need to give up, to let go, depart from, in order to obey the gospel of Christ. Hence the reason why Jesus said in Matthew chapter 16, for verse number 24, if any man will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whosoever will save his life will lose it. Whosoever loses life for my sake shall find it. For what is it profit if a man gain the whole world and lose his own soul? Or what shall a man give in exchange for his soul? Jesus is calling us through the gospel. And Simon, when he obeyed the gospel and he wanted to teach us that there is possibilities and the reality exists that anyone could come from a background of doing things that they ought not to do, but to change their lives and to come to Christ, the gospel has the power to bring forth that change. Why not obey the gospel of Christ today? You have heard the message. Believe in Jesus. Repent of your sins. Confess that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, and be baptized, have your sins washed away, so the Lord could add you to his church, and you would also be in his kingdom. That is what is awaiting you at this time. So I trust that as you consider what the word of God is saying to you, that you would certainly obey the wonderful gospel of Christ. Remember to subscribe and click on that bell, and you have all the information given to you pertaining to the churches of Christ. May God bless you, and may God keep you in Jesus.
I believe. What the Bible tells me, I believe. That he died on Calvary, I believe. That he came to set me free indeed. So I might live with him in glory. I believe. What the Bible tells me, I believe. That he died on Calvary, I believe. That he came to set me free indeed. So I might live with him in glory.